So this next section is a little less of a multi-cloud. It's more of a discussion about storing and querying a data lake. And we're going to use an open source tool, Trino, to be able to query the data. It's my good fortune that I get to present this to you after Andy Klein has given you an introduction to Drive Stats, because what we will use for our sample data will be an all year's collection of Drive Stats. And as I mentioned earlier, we're now finishing out our 10th year of sharing our operational data. So Backblaze is a very uniquely open company, especially in the cloud. I know of no other company that shares actual operational data, especially in real time as we do with Drive Stats. So we'll highlight as an opener, just some of the benefits of B2 cloud storage. Now, these benefits are not unique to using B2 as a data lake. These are actually universal benefits, so it'll be a bit of a refresher for everybody. Then we'll do the demo using Trino for our all year's Drive Stats. And then at the back end, I'll come back and give you a little bit of backfill on data lake analytics and why it can be very, very compelling, and also highlight that we're using an open source project, one of several that you could choose to do the querying of the data inside of the data lake that is on B2. But big picture, this is all an open source party. So I'm very happy to call that out. Similar to the prior demo, I just want to call out that I'm really going to talk to two different audiences. On the left, I'm highlighting here an audience labeled as everyone, and then off to the right, specialists. And we at Backblaze are making an initiative in this area of using B2 as a data lake. So if you are a specialist, we are especially interested in hearing from you because we're building out enablement. And if you work with customers, we are very interested in working with you to have you work in concert with us to make sure that we're delivering the easiest experience for customers in doing data lake. But in terms of everyone, ultimately, almost everybody takes a look at data. Now, this session also is going to have some shared notes. And I need to go and fish those up. Give me one second here. This is not it. This is it. Good. Okay. No. Bear with me one sec. I hadn't quite cleanly planned for this transition. There we go. So the URL that was on the screen brings us over to this shared set of notes. And what this demo is going to give you just a skim of the surface of is described in really great detail in this blog post article, which focuses on storing and querying analytic data in Backblaze B2. So I'm giving you the quick run through. And if you want to take more of a deep dive, I encourage you to come to this blog post and understand a lot of the architecture, as well as we did some optional optimizations. So it's not strictly required that you do some data engineering work that we have done. So you have that available. And I'll come back to the browse files later. So, and I also have links, other helpful links here. So links for Drive Stats. Importantly, though, where my cursor is right now is highlighting that we are sharing for the first time the data set for Drive Stats so that you don't need to download the files. We're going to continue to distribute Drive Stats as we always have every quarter, CSVs you can download, run them on your own storage and query them as you want. But we've created a all year's copy at this endpoint and a read-only key pair that you can use so you can recreate this. Also, I'm going to be using a Docker container. Pat had been using Docker earlier. And if you would like a copy of this Docker container, just if you could follow up with an email to evangelism@backblaze.com, we'll get that for you. It's an all open source stack. So this is a great open source party. And then I'm going to leave this over here because that's Trino console. And let me get my presentation notes up here. And actually, it's already running. Okay, so before I talk about data lake, I want to talk about the benefits of Backblaze B2 Cloud Storage. These benefits are accrue to almost every workload that runs on top of Backblaze B2, but they're especially helpful for data lake. First, as a server, B2 being a serverless service, you don't need to make any provisioning decisions. You create an account and you create a bucket and you start right away writing to that bucket, and you enjoy the fault tolerance that we have from having sharded the data across 20 drives, and you know validation that we're for real because you can go and look at our drive stats. So anyway, pre-provisioned storage, no planning required. Our Backblaze B2 service team is doing that for you. That fault tolerance is delivering you what we call 11 nines of durability. If you're unacquainted, the notion of 11 nines is that there are 11 nines here to the right, and there's a decimal place after the first two. We would like to be able to tell you that you have 100% reliance on B2, and that we will be able to return your data against any imaginable shortcoming that may occur, but we can't. So this is just shy of 100%, but our highly fault-tolerant architecture is resilient, and you can have nearly 100% confidence you'll get your data back. And further reinforce, if it's truly critical data, if you were to implement replication between two different regions, that will even make this reliability even greater. So when you write your data to Backblaze B2, as we had mentioned earlier, we sharded across 20 different drives. That delivers the fault tolerance so that if one drive fails underneath, your data is still 11 nines safe. And keep in mind, you're getting a service here, and our service team is working round the clock 24/7 to monitor. And as drives may fail, and we know they are drive stats, they get our redundancy back up to that full complement of 20 shards as soon as possible. Also, great benefit is the affordability. So we have free egress with some of our compute partners. So for Data Lake, you might be running compute on Vulture or Equinix Metal, or if you're hosting data, which is not really applicable to data lakes, you could use a CDN. Also, that free universal data migration service, it's just a great way of easing and moving your data in. So data has a life cycle. It may have its moment of origination out in mobile apps and devices, or you might already have your data collected up in another environment, so that universal data migration can help bring the data in. So in terms of having a life cycle, to the left on this diagram is highlighting some of the journey data has. All data has one moment of origination. Then you need to have something in your workflow to capture that data at its moment of origination. It might be mobile apps or some sort of web-based applications like BitCartel or CanStock Photo are using. It might be media files, Internet of Things, databases, logs, but wherever the data has its moment of origination, you can bring that data into B2. From a data analytics perspective, once the data is on B2, you can now analyze it. Now, much of what the word data lake is referring to is an evolution from something pioneered by an open source project called Hadoop. And there is now a Hadoop, not just project, but a Hadoop ecosystem. And inside of that ecosystem, there are many different ways that you can get answers from your data. So SQL, which is what most people associate with a database, is what we're going to demonstrate here. There's also artificial intelligence and machine learning, or directed acyclic graphs with Apache Spark, or all of the tools in the original Hadoop ecosystem. But ultimately, the reason organizations are doing this is to drive to decisions. So back to drive stats, we at Backblaze need to know what are the reliability of our drives, where we should give priority. As Andy was hinting, it even gives us a window into as drives are getting older. So we might proactively trade them out. So there's a wide variety of decisions that organizations are making every day. And by having your data up inside of B2, you can go and access it. Now, One thing we're going to have demonstrated is a suggested best practice for faster query performance. However, you can always go and just query raw files. And a classic example are log files. Now, a lot of organizations will set up a data pipeline that will take the raw data, and we call them ETL pipelines. They'll extract it from the raw form, E for extract, T for transform, and then load it into a destination. But in doing that, you know what the schema, we'll call it, to use the database term, of the data is. So what we're going to be demonstrating is that really neat concept where you don't have to create the table and then insert the data into it. You can take that table definition and send it to an engine like Trino, and it knows how the data is stored and skip that ETL pipeline step. The number one thing we're always looking to do is have cost-effective storage and get the best performance. And so we're going to have a demonstration of a recommended best practice, not required, of partitioning your data, which for folks who work with databases is like setting a sort key on your data. It could be a primary key or what Oracle calls an index organized table. And then secondarily, we went with the drive stats data and created a version in an open source format called Parquet. And the benefit of Parquet is that it stores the data column by column, which when you think of databases, you always think, oh, I'm going to retrieve the data row by row. So I already went out and highlighted that on the notes section for this session. There is a link to this article. This will take you in a step-by-step guide on what the data looks like when we query it in raw form versus when we have it transformed with partitions and Parquet. And also sharing with you the endpoint and key pair. And if you would like a copy of the container, give us a holler by email and we'll do that. So in terms of getting Trino up and going, I think I already have the Trino console here. So this will show us activity that's running on top of Trino. And then second, I have got a command prompt. Now, Trino will be able to be used by any tool that can connect with ODBC or JDBC. So I'm just kicking it old school here using a raw command prompt. And I've got a handful, not a lot, but just a handful of queries to demonstrate how the system works. So I'm going to just paste in here something that's going to select and give me a count of however many records are inside of the all years data set. So right now, just so you know, the data is living on B2, and we use the endpoint and the key pair and our configurations so that Trino can now talk to B2. I just happen to be running that compute engine here on my workstation with a container. But an important thing to know about data lake technologies, and this is engines like Trino for SQL, as well as the artificial intelligence and the machine learning, is that they support distributed processing. So we could collapse these runtimes even more by having multiple computes running at the same time. Trino handles all that in our case. So this ran and it took about 11 seconds, and it's highlighting that what I got back was it needed to touch, in doing the processing, 346 million rows. And the result of the total records is 346 million rows. Now, this type of query in the world of data analytics is known as a full table scan. And these are the most expensive types of queries. So I need to go out and get information about every one of the rows that are stored inside of it. So I'm going to run another full table scan query this time, but actually let me get the SQL off there so we can come back and see the real-time feedback. And what I'm watching to see is when parallelism comes into play. So even though I do not have a distributed cluster, Trino, as well as most data lake technologies, have the ability to span out horizontally. We would call that horizontal scaling where we add more nodes into our cluster. So what I've done here is I said, well, please return to me what unique years we have data for, and for each year, what are the total number of stats? And Andy explained that we effectively take one reading per drive every day. And so these numbers are showing that we've been increasing year by year. Now, if you look and get into drive stats, we didn't have full year for 2013. So the fact, I think we had 8 months there. So the fact that 2014 was a higher number was not all that impressive. And don't be concerned that this number is lower than last year, because for 2022, because we only have 9 months of data. So we still have a full quarter's worth of data that has not yet been added into the drive stats. But in terms of the metrics I'm looking at down below here, this took about 7 seconds, so far faster than our prior one. But again, it's touching 346 million rows. So let me go and grab another query. And this is gonna be very similar to the one I just ran. It's just going to add an additional value, which is, in addition to telling me the years and the number of drives, it's also going to tell me how many unique models of drive were being run in those years. And so this is a little bit more compute intensive. And I'm waiting for that to finish up. And while that's going on, I'm just going to come over to my console. Sorry. I'm going to need to refresh and re-log in here. So I just want to get that going while that query is running. Copy. Good. And in a moment, I'll explain how we have the data laid out here. So on the left-hand side here, I'll choose Browse Files. And this is the account that's actually hosting the data. And inside of that, we see we have a bucket named Drive Stats Parquet. But let me come back to that in just a moment. So this query finished, and it took quite a bit longer period of time, but we have added in here information about how many models were being run in each year. So you can go and do any type of query you would like against the full drive stats data. And so just to wind this up, I want to set up the next query, because this query goes super fast. This query is not doing a full table scan. So let me bring up our cluster overview. Rather, in this case, I'm going to go and say, I need to get information about a specific year and a specific month. And we see that query came back in less than 1 second. It touched not a full table scan. It touched just over 6.36 million records. And the reason why it was able to perform so fast is this notion of partitions. So inside of our bucket, which is Drive Stats Parquet, now remember, this is not required. This just helps you get faster retrieval. And data has a life cycle. So you'll often query your data innumerable times over its lifestyle. We have a directory inside of that bucket named Drive Stats. And when I drill inside of that, what we've done is set up what we refer to as a partition. You can physically sort your data one way. And folks who have been database administrators are aware, so they set up sort keys or primary keys, or again, Oracle calls it an index-organized table. So when Trino needs to go and get data for just 2022, it can not do any reads for the years that don't qualify. So it drills directly into year 2022. So the best way to get fastest performance against a very large data set is no IO for data that's going to resolve to false. So you just don't even read that data. So partitions enable us to do that. And then our query went in for the month of 06, which was June. And then when we come inside here, that's where we see the files. And these files are being stored with an extension .parquet. And this is all open source. This is a total open source party. And Parquet is a columnar storage. So that's pretty much everything I had to do here for the demo. I need to just wrap up quick. There are a few more little points here on the slide, but I'm going to be handing this off in a moment to let Gleb come back and say goodbye to everybody and send you off. But remember, analytics just means I have data and I need to get answers from my data. Today you have data, a wealth of data. And when you do analytic workloads, you often pull data from two or more points of origin in order to set up a queryable data set that will be able to answer the questions that you know you need to answer. So again, we use drive stats as operational data that we need to know about. So all data has a life cycle, moment of origination. Eventually, you might delete that data. There often is a pipeline of ETL that's used, and over data's lifetime, you might query that same data over and over again. So what we highlighted here was just using SQL, but in Data Lake. There are many other open source technologies that also could be simultaneously reading that data. So they're not mutually exclusive. We could be running our Trino queries with SQL, use artificial intelligence, machine learning, directed acyclic graph with Apache Spark, or using any of the tools in the Hadoop ecosystem. And just to highlight, if for some reason SQL's new to you, I just wanted to highlight that SQL is a core competency most organizations have. Stack Overflow does a developer survey, and for their subset this year of professional developers, of which they had over 53,000, the top three common programming languages that developers have that skill in their tool set are JavaScript first, HTML and CSS third, and SQL third. And so if you are not yet using SQL, I highly encourage you to take a look at using SQL. It is something that we anticipate is going to be around for many years to come. And then this is just my last goodbye, a reminder of letting you know that we at Backblaze are a uniquely open company. We, in 2009, open sourced our hardware design. Then in 2015, we've also open sourced that Reed-Solomon enclosure encoding, which is what we use to shard the data across 20 drives to deliver that fault tolerance that delivers 11 nines of durability. And we are really, really unique in sharing our operational data. So Backblaze is open source, open data, and also a very open culture. And with that, I'm done. So I will let somebody hand this back, but let everybody know, please do give a review if you would like. And if you have any follow-on questions, let us know. And back to you, Gleb.
Thanks, Greg. Appreciate that overview.
We need to open up the audio.
Hopefully you can all hear me. So thanks, Greg, for that. And thank you, everybody, for joining us for the last couple hours and digging into this. Hopefully you learned something. There was maybe some concrete takeaways that can help you for yourself, for your organization, as you're developing applications. You know, I think we all know data is mission critical. It's also literally central to our modern existence. And our mission here at Backblaze is to make it astonishingly easy for you to store the data, but also to protect it and also to use it. And I think this latest example was a good one of ways in which we can help you use your data. So this is a wrap for Tech Day 2022, but watch for a follow-up thank you email from us and let us know what you found most helpful, any feedback for the future, and also how we can help you build and scale your applications and your organizations. Thank you so much. See you next time. Bye-bye.